Hello, I'm Graham and welcome to today's video. In this video I will demonstrate the control of the Panasonic Lumix FZ1000 through Panasonic's Image App program. In this video I'll be using the latest version of iOS and the latest version of the Image App. In a separate video I will also demonstrate the connection via the Android OS. Okay, the first thing to do is to download the app from the App Store if you've not already done so. So our first operation is to download from your iOS device connected to the internet the application from the App Store. So clicking the App Store icon, if you search for the Panasonic Image app, you'll find that the app is available. It's a free download. Click the download icon to start the download onto your device. And the Image app itself allows you to transfer images from the camera or to remotely control it, as we're going to do in the next application. It takes just a couple of minutes to download the app. When it's fully downloaded, it will ask you to open the app and then we can continue with the connectivity to the camera itself. Right, the app's fully downloaded and now it gives us the operation of opening the app. When we press open, the app is now asking, would you like to be sent notifications? Say don't allow that, you only want to be able to connect to the app when you go from your home screen. And now the app is looking for connection to the camera. And there are two methods of connection. One is by directly inputting the passcode from the camera to your iOS device. Or the second one, if your device supports it, is the QR code. Now with the iPad it supports QR collection, with the iPod Touch it doesn't support it. So it depends on your particular application which method you use to input the connection algorithm. In this case I'm going to use the QR code. So when I click QR code, it will bring up a target on your device. And you'll place that target over the generated QR code on the back of the camera and that will start the communication process. So that's the first step. We've got the iPad ready now to receive the QR code from the camera. We just need to enable the camera in the Wi-Fi mode to generate that QR code. So I'll just move the iPad out of the way and bring in the camera. And from the Function 2 button on the top of the camera, we can invoke the Wi-Fi menu. So just pressing the Wi-Fi button, it will bring up the Wi-Fi operation and you notice we've got a blue LED on the top of the camera, which means we've got the Wi-Fi in operation. Now you notice on the LCD screen it's generated a QR code. Now if your camera has got a high resolution you can use that image itself, but if your camera is fairly low resolution, if you press the menu set button it enlarges that QR code. So I'm now going to place the iPad camera in front of that QR code to try and capture it. So I'll place the iPad camera in a position so that it captures the QR code from the device. And you'll notice on the screen it's asking you to install a profile. You'll notice it's brought up on screen the option here to install a profile. Now that's new with the new iOS system and you must install that, otherwise you can't get this QR code to connect. So by pressing the install button, if you have a passcode on your device you need to re-enter that to enable you to install the profile. It's warning you that the profile is not signed, but continue with that anyway. So in install, install the profile, confirm. And now it tells you the profile has been installed. So click done. Now that is part of the operation. Now we need to go back to the home screen on your device. And you'll find that you've got the Panasonic Image app there. Before we can use that app, we need to now switch into the settings of your device and come out of the Wi-Fi that's connected to the internet. If you come out of your internet connection you'll see that you've got in your other network options the install profile for the FZ1000 camera. So if I just touch that, it will now attempt to connect via the Wi-Fi to your camera. We don't have to enter the SSID, that's already done for us, and we don't need to enter the passcode because that's done by the QR code. So now we can go back to the home screen, find our image app, and start the image app. You now notice that it's connecting to camera. It's upset to the camera and everything's ready to go. We just need to press now remote operation. It gives you a warning if you've set that up in the menu and it's there by default that the camera lens will extend. When you press that, the camera will now switch over and you can see on screen we've got the connection between the camera and your iOS device. I'll reset up the camera on the iPad so we can have a look through some of the operations of the image app. So this is the Panasonic image app user interface. Part of the screen is taken up by the camera status, so you can see we've got aperture priority set, we're in the standard photo style, the plus symbol means we've got some modifications made to that. We've got MP4 full HD 50p set as a video mode. My stills mode is set to 16:9 with the large JPEG fine quality, autofocus single area and single point of focus. Along the bottom we can see we're in the whole area metering, we've got an aperture of f4, the shutter speed is 1/2.5, this is the exposure meter, currently showing 2/3 of a stop overexposed, and I've got an ISO set of 400. On the right hand side of the screen we've got control of things like the zoom, so we can actually change the zoom directly from this screen. In manual focus we can actually change the focus of the camera by varying the focal point, so we can zoom, focus in and focus out, and you notice we get the magnified view. And by using the touch screen we can actually focus on the point that we want to look at the critical focus, we don't have to use that on the camera. So if I wanted to focus now on that car, I can bring the focus point to the front and we can see that the wheels are sharp, or if I wanted to look at the flower behind, then again I could change the focus until the flower is sharp. You might notice on the bottom of the screen we have an indication of where we are within the focus mechanism between infinity and close up, but we don't get a distance readout, it's just an indication of where we are. If we press exit, that will take us back to the main screen. From this screen we can set things like white balance. So here we've got auto white balance, but if I wanted to set one of the other presets, then I can scroll through and set up that white balance. And again, to return to the main screen, we'll use the return icon. You can change the ISO, and again you get access to the ISO. Once you've set it, return to the main operating screen. Control over exposure compensation. And again, we can go from the -5 to the +5. Here we can see we've got +2/3 of an EV set on our camera. We can change that if we need to whatever we need. And again, return to the main screen by pressing the return key. On the later versions of this app, you can actually use the camera controls as well as the on-screen controls. But the idea of the remote app is that you've got the camera set up in a remote location and you shouldn't have to be able to use the camera itself. So if you wanted something like shutter priority, it's best to set that up before you start the image app. Here I've got the camera on the bench, so I could actually change to shutter priority mode if I wanted to by turning the mode dial on the top of the camera. And you can see we've got the camera operation is in progress, but now the camera's changed to shutter priority mode and the aperture has now changed to shutter speed. So if I press shutter speed, it now allows me to change the value of the shutter speed and the camera will react accordingly to give me the right exposure. Once you've got the shutter speed set how you want it, then you can use the return to come back to the main menu. Now, the beauty of the system is that the FZ1000 doesn't have a touchscreen, but your interface device does. So if I wanted to focus on this car, for example, I can touch on the screen the point that I want the camera to focus. So if I touch the wheel here, the camera will focus at that position. If I wanted to focus on the flower, then I just touch the flower, and again the camera will focus on the flower. So it means that if you're recording video, you can actually do a focus pull. So if I start recording video, so now recording Full HD 50p MP4, so if I wanted to do a focus pull from the flower to the car, all I have to do is touch the car and the camera would rack forward to bring that car into focus. If I want to do a transition from foreground to background, if I press the flower, the camera will drive itself to the flower. So that's a useful device for doing focus pulls in your video. You've also got the operation here of the touch shutter. So when you're in the stills mode, the point that you touch on screen, the camera will focus and fire the exposure. So if I touch the wheel again, you'll notice that the camera's initially focused on the flower. If I touch the wheel, the camera will immediately focus on the wheel and take the picture. And again, if I focus on the flower, it focuses on the flower and takes a picture. And this is done at the full speed at which the camera will focus. To turn that off, just touch that icon again and it prevents the camera from exposing. It will just focus on that position. This icon here is the automatic exposure, and I could use that for measuring the exposure at a critical point of the image. So if I wanted this car to be the critical point, if it's in shadow or it's in a different light to the background, if I set automatic exposure, you'll notice that I get a target cross. Now I can place that target cross where I want on this particular model. If I set it there, it will now set the exposure when I press the set key to give me the right exposure for that car. So even if I change my focus point, the exposure is always taken from this particular point. To reset, just take the AE lock off. And if you want to reset where your focus point is, if you press reset, that will bring it back to the center of the screen. This icon here allows you to define the autofocus method. If I wanted to go into the 49 area mode, so if I press 49 area, you can see we get the 49 area symbol on the screen. Come back to the shooting menu. If I select an area of focus, you notice we get the whole matrix coming up to show me what the camera is considering as the focus points. So if I take the picture, it will have focused on that car. If I focus over here on the flower, there's more of the image considered to be in focus. When I click the camera icon, it will take the picture there. Gain access to the Q menu from this device as well, so you can set up the photo style, aspect ratio, picture size, quality. You can go into the macro mode, metering mode, flash mode, and set your video recording quality. Return back using the return cursor. If your camera supports dedicated 4K photo mode, which the FZ1000 unfortunately doesn't, the icon here will give you access to shooting the burst mode photo mode of the, say, FZ330 or the GX8. Here with the FZ1000, all you can do is set up for 4K photo mode, but we record it as an MP4 file. So if I press the record button, the camera is recording in 4K video at 25p, and I could select the still frame from that to simulate the 4K photo mode. But with a camera which has a dedicated photo mode, the icon here gives you access to shooting the burst mode or pre-burst mode. If we turn the dial to the auto bracket mode, indicated by the plus and minus icon here on the icon stack, we touch that, we can set up the increment and the number of exposures in our auto bracket sequence. If we want to use burst mode shooting, then we turn to the burst mode icon, which is the next on the mode dial. You can see we have the burst mode of operation, and you can select between medium, low, high and super high speed burst shooting mode. If you want to turn off the real estate information from the camera, by hitting the display option you can turn that information off and just be left with the main controls for the application itself. Now that we've once connected to the application, if we start the camera and the iPad again, we don't need to go through the QR code collection again. We just need to select it from the destination that appears in the camera history. To reconnect a second and subsequent time, if I press the function 2, the Wi-Fi button on the camera, you'll see that it brings up a menu which includes select a destination from history. And if I cursor down to that point, select a destination from history, it knows we've already made a connection to the image app on the iPad. So to connect the camera to the app, we need to just press the menu set, and that is now waiting to connect to the iPad. But we need to go into the settings menu, and from the networks, choose the FZ1000 again, because that's the network we want to connect to. Wait for the camera to connect to the app. Come back to the home screen and start the image app. Get the usual warning that the lens will extend. And we're back in control of the camera itself. So that is the Panasonic Lumix FZ1000 being controlled from the image app that's installed on an iOS device. You can see it offers up tremendous potential for remote shooting. You can have the camera set up in a dangerous location so you can actually film an event taking place without any danger to yourself. You can have the camera set up to a bird hide and then be able to monitor any activity on your hide and then shoot video or stills from that remote location. You could even put the camera on a telescopic pole and shoot from way above the head of a crowd, or hanging out the camera from the top floor of a building to take some spectacular shots. It's only limited by your imagination. Also from this imaging app, apart from live control, we have the playback option. So if I click the playback icon on the bottom of the screen, the camera will now display the images that are on the memory card. And again, it would depend on your camera device and the iOS device as to whether you can actually replay things like video clips. You can see I can select any image on the screen and view it in full size on the iPad device. If I just touch the image again, I can enlarge it by double clicking, so I can actually look at the image quality. Double click again, go back to the original size, click outside the image, and you can come back to the overlay. If I click on one of the video files and press play, so you can actually see, we can actually replay a video. The top left hand icon here allows you to change between the camera and your camera roll on your iPod device. So if I press camera roll, it will actually switch through and show me the images that are on my iPod device. So if I wanted to compare images, for example, then I can come back to the iPad. If I again double click on that, you can see that I bring up a full resolution. If I double click on that, we get the expanded display, so you can actually see the quality of the images from your camera. Coming back to the home screen, you get the opportunity to transfer images from the camera to your iOS device. We need to click the select icon, and now it allows me to individually select the images that I want to transfer across to the iPad. Once we've done that, we just need to click the icon at the bottom of the screen, which is transfer to the smart device, the iOS device, or we can share it with things like Facebook or the Lumix Club, or we can delete those particular images that we selected. So if I transfer them to the iPad, it's copying one of four files, two of four files, three of four files, four of four, until those 4 meg JPEGs have come across to the iPad device. And they will go into your camera roll. Once I've transferred them, I've got the operation now. I can either leave them as they are, or I could actually delete those images from the camera itself. You see, it's deleted those four images. Another feature of the app is actually to create a photo collage. If you click the photo collage operation, it then says how do you want to display that frame. So you can select any one of the templates that's available. So if I click this one, we'll have five images, and it will bring up then the images that are on your Lumix roll, the one that's in the camera. From that, you'll select your five images to be combined into your collage. So if I set five of these car images and then press execute, it will combine those into the one collage. So those are the five images, and that is the collage that the app has created for us. I can actually save it to the iPad by clicking this icon, and the picture's been saved. So there we are. That is the Panasonic Image app running from the iOS device controlling the FZ1000. It will depend on your iOS device and the version of the Image app that allows it to be downloaded, and the particular type of camera as to what will be seen on the screen. So until my next video, thanks very much for watching. Please do take care, and I'll see you in my next video. Goodbye for now.